course.
Yeah. Thank you for coming to BookFilter. I'm talking with John Allen, Jr. Do you say Jr. when you talk to people?
Well, I do, although I've noticed this is my 10th book. Every one of them that's been marketed in the UK market, they strip the Jr. out, because apparently in, like, regal English, Jr. is not acknowledged. But I'd like to hold on to it. Sure.
You're either, like, the second in the UK, or you just don't matter until you're the third.
Yeah, I think that's exactly it.
I'm actually a British subject. I was born in Bermuda, so I should have known that. But okay. So they just get rid of the Jr. completely.
Strip it out.
All right. Well, your new book is, of course, The Francis Miracle. I'll put up a card on the screen so they can see the cover. And it's a book about Pope Francis. It has a biographical section on it, but it's really a look at his papacy and a snapshot of where he's at and the issues that he's facing. But a lot of people, of course, know you, but I think we should introduce you a little bit. You grew up in Kansas?
Western Kansas, mm-hmm. God's country.
Do you know what's wrong with Kansas or what the matter is with Kansas, or was it great when you were growing up?
I actually read that book, What's the Matter with Kansas, and I think I'm more confused now than I was before I began about exactly what's going on. In my opinion, there's not a whole lot wrong with Kansas, to be honest with you. Never was. Great place to grow up, great place to be from.
Mm-hmm. I'm a little confused about your leap into journalism. I know you went to college, you went to Catholic school, just like me as a kid. You went to college and you studied philosophy, and then you got a master's in religious studies.
Mm-hmm.
And then you were a high school teacher teaching journalism and overseeing the high school newspaper, which, like, the biggest decision is, should you put the photo of the basketball team on the cover or the photo of the debate team? That's, you know, what's going to be on the front page. And then somehow you...
Yeah, okay, answer to that question, basketball always wins.
Well, then, my friends are debates, so we would not, you know...
Hey, I was a state champion high school debater, baby. I mean, I'm all in with high school debate, but I'm just telling you, from the point of view of sexiness as a news story, the basketball team generally is going to win.
What if debate wins state and high school just had a game?
We were on an inside pitch.
All right. So how did you make that leap into I should say, actual journalism, but you know what I mean, from high school over...
Oh, no. I mean, listen, I'm a complete journalistic phony, okay? I mean, the way this worked was I was out in Southern California trying to get a doctorate in scripture studies, actually. My wife and I had just gotten married, and like every couple just starting out, we were trying to figure out how we're going to pay the bills. And I said, well, listen, I will try to take some kind of part-time job that will buy us some time, right? Now, you're 22 years old. You've got a master's degree in religion, okay? What kind of part-time job are you going to get that is not like flipping hamburgers, right? And so it occurred to me, well, I could teach in a Catholic school. Because like an idiot, I thought, well, you know, they get done at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. That's a part-time job, right?
That's right.
And so I interviewed at a couple of places. I was actually hired to teach religion. It was a complete accident that this place also happened to have a journalism class. And nobody in the grand tradition of Catholic secondary education, no one even remotely qualified to teach it. Remember, the principal asked me during the interview, hey, we have this journalism class. Could we give you that? Do you have any background in journalism? To which my answer was, well, I read the paper, and I guess that was good enough, you know? And then very quickly, to be honest, what happened was I started envying my kids. I mean, you know, they were out hustling for news and doing stories, and that all looked very cool to me. So I started freelancing at a couple different places. I realized you could get paid to write about religion without learning Hebrew and Sanskrit and without using footnotes. That sounded like a pretty sweet deal.
Mm-hmm.
And so I decided to sort of try my luck, and the rest is history.
Well, what was that first job? Or what was that first gig that you got?
Believe it or not, my first paid writing gig had nothing to do with the Catholic Church. I was writing a classic car column for the Antelope Valley Press. I can't even change my own oil, right? So yeah. I was writing these pieces about the 57 Chevy as a metaphor for social change in post-war Los Angeles, mm-hmm. you know, which I'm sure all the car guys wondered, what the hell is this,
yeah.
you know? But I floated a couple of ideas to the National Catholic Reporter, which was a nationally distributed paper that covers the Catholic Church. They liked the ideas. Before very long, they had offered me a job, and there we are.
And suddenly you went off to Rome. And you seemed to have a big impact right away. Maybe it took 5 years, but from the outside, it looked like, oh, you went to Rome and everything was swimming. You learned Italian. You learned some other languages too, didn't you?
No, just Italian.
Just Italian.
Yes.
You already spoke Latin.
The Italian, the Vatican is one of the most stubbornly monolingual environments on earth, actually, which is both a blessing and a curse. The curse is it's either sink or swim in terms of mastery of Italian. The flip side is once you've mastered the Italian, you can pretty much do whatever you want.
Mm-hmm.
Listen, did it happen quickly? I certainly experienced it as if it happened quickly. There were a lot of stops and starts along the way. But let me say this. I had the good fortune, and that's all it was, dumb luck, okay, of arriving in Rome at a time when most other American media organizations were pulling back in terms of international coverage generally. And in terms of coverage of the Vatican specifically, I mean, most of the big major American outlets had just kind of left a skeleton crew waiting for the Pope to die. These are the late John Paul years we're talking about. And then all of a sudden, three things happened right in a row. Okay, one, you got 9/11, the clash of civilizations, so the engagement between Christianity and Islam seemed hugely important. Second, you got the explosion of the sexual abuse crisis in the United States, 2002. All of a sudden, the Vatican became an enormously relevant beat for the American market. And then you got the twilight of the John Paul years, because what no one really realized is that the transition story is not going to start when John Paul dies. It starts the first time he goes into the hospital. Mm-hmm. Okay. Those three things, one right after another, all of a sudden, and I was kind of like the only guy standing for a while in terms of covering this for the American market. So I went from being a total nobody to being like the premier American Vaticanista.
By default.
By default. Yeah, yeah. Exactly. That's what it was.
But that was my question. When you arrived, was it 98?
98.
Yeah. Was there anybody else from a major print outlet who was there full-time covering? I mean, they had freelancers, I'm sure, who picked up
Nobody stuff. Was really doing it for the American market now, right? Okay, because we have to distinguish. I
of
mean,
course.
In Italy, you know, the Vatican is the White House. It's the A beat on every newspaper. There are two or three Vatican correspondents.
Berlusconi.
Well, Berlusconi was hot for a while, but that was about his personality.
Yeah.
Okay, I mean, prime ministers come and go. The papacy endures, as far as the Italians are concerned. I mean, they know it's their crown jewel, and they cover it that way.
It's like the royal family, perhaps,
yeah.
in a way?
Well, it's like the royal family and the White House rolled into one, because it's also a policy beat. Mm-hmm. But look, I mean, in terms of the American market, you know, so the bigger American print outlets had people in Rome, but the Vatican was one item on a 20-item to-do list, okay? Most of the big American TV nets actually didn't have correspondents full-time based in Rome at that stage. They just had producers, and they would rotate in correspondents as the news seemed to warrant. Even in the specialized Catholic world, the number of people who were doing this in the English language was very small. You had the Catholic News Service, which is the kind of official news agency of the U.S. Bishops' Conference. You had a couple of U.K. outlets, and that was basically it. I mean, it was an extremely small pool.
And for the U.K., that must be a hobby.
I mean, it's very different now,
yeah.
Okay, which is one measure of the Francis effect. You know, that everybody feels like they need to have somebody on the ground covering this beat today.
How bizarre that seems. I mean, the influence of Rome and the number of Catholics around the world, it just seems odd to me that even pulling back, it seems like you're going to have someone in London, you're going to have someone in Paris.
Yeah.
How could you not have someone in the back?
Well, I mean, that's a symptom of a bigger problem, okay? And the bigger problem is that historically, when you look at the way American journalism organizes itself, we have not taken religion seriously as a news beat. We have not invested anything in coverage of religion like we invest in politics or finance,
or
for that matter, sports or entertainment,
yeah.
Right? I mean, religion has long been a kind of episodic dip-in and dip-out beat, which is problematic in and of itself. Now, when you apply that to the Vatican, which is a completely different cultural world from Main Street USA, and you can't cover it on a part-time basis, this has been kind of a perfect storm in terms of discussion of the Vatican over the years in the American media. You have a news beat that requires full-time expertise being covered by people who have never been given the opportunity to develop it.
And don't know what the Immaculate Conception is.
Yeah, I mean, who don't know what the Immaculate Conception is, right?
Just like most Catholics.
Yes, who think it has something to do with Jesus,
yeah.
Right?
So that was very exciting. Did you realize how lucky you were in the sense that, like, why isn't anybody else here covering the Rome?
No, to be honest with you, at the time, it was just all happening too fast, mm-hmm. For it really to soak in. It was really only with the benefit of hindsight that I looked back and realized how I had kind of won the lottery. I mean, in the sense that I didn't arrive with any particular expertise, I certainly didn't arrive with any reputation. And frankly, I mean, this is not rocket science. I mean, it just takes time on task, okay? I had the luxury of being able to put that time on task, you know, to develop the expertise at a time when, in our market, really nobody else was doing it. And so, you know, all of a sudden, I'm writing op-ed pieces for the New York Times, and I got a contract with CNN, and I'm doing books, and I'm on the lecture circuit. And all of this was just happening. It was like one domino following after another that you didn't really absorb it in that moment.
Mm-hmm. You've had, this is your 10th book?
Yeah.
You've had books about, two biographies about the man who would become Pope Benedict. You've had books about the persecution of Catholics around the world. You had a book on Opus Dei, my personal favorite. That's always exciting. Opus Dei is fun. You try to take some of the fun out of it, I must admit. But
yeah, I both created and destroyed an industry in one fell swoop.
Or at least
right?
You tried
Opus Dei exposés.
Yes. And one of the fascinating things I found was how you did your first look at Pope Benedict when he was a cardinal, Cardinal Ratzinger. And you heard people's response to it, and you were like, yeah, you know, I could have done a better job.
Yeah.
Which is unusual. But, I mean, writing a book is a very different challenge. And what did you learn and what did you grow? And
well, my first book on Ratzinger, this was in the late 90s when he was still Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger, the Vatican's doctrinal czar. That was done when during a brief window of time when I was living in Kansas City working out of the newsroom of the National Catholic Reporter. I had never been to Rome. I had never done a reporting trip on the Catholic Church in any other part of the world. I had basically the kind of formation you get up, you know, you develop going to Mass in the Midwestern United States and then reading news clippings. In other words, I think that book sort of exceeded my reach. Now, I don't think it was without its merits, let me just say, and neither did Cardinal Ratzinger at the time, nor does Pope Benedict, but I remember the first review of that book was done by the Dean of Church Historians in America, a guy by the name of Monsignor Joseph Kamanchak at Catholic University, most respected church historian in the States. And he accused me of Manichaean journalism, by which he meant that I had this kind of dualistic view of things, that whenever there was a debate between Cardinal Ratzinger and his critics were always right. And my first reaction was to be angry and defensive, but with a little time, I was able to go back and look at the book, and I concluded that there was a sense in which he was right. Not because I was deliberately setting out to write a hatchet job, but simply I didn't know the material well enough to know how these issues would look through Ratzinger's eyes. And at that stage, you know, I had a decision to make. I asked myself, do I want to be remembered as the kind of journalist who kind of fueled the culture wars, or the guy who did whatever he could in his own modest way to try to dial them down? And I chose the latter, and that's kind of what I wanted my career to be about ever since.
But that's no way to get clickbait. And one of the big reasons I think you were able to propel yourself and were able to gain visibility was, of course, being online. And the online column that you would have that people could access much more easily when print was the only way to get your news information.
Yeah, back when I started what was then called The Word from Rome, which again, we're talking the late 90s, it was absolutely unique, at least in the world of like Vatican and Catholic coverage. I mean, nobody else was really doing online columns. Believe it or not, I mean, this is how naive I was at the stage. I pitched that to my boss at the National Catholic Reporter on this basis. I said, look, I know all the good, important stuff is what I'm going to be writing for the paper, but I'm collecting a bunch of other stuff that is just like lost value if we don't have some other outlet for it. So maybe I can do something on the website that will just be kind of like Vatican Notebook, like the odds and ends that doesn't really rate.
Like Alistair Cook.
Yeah, you know, that kind of stuff.
Talking about America.
Right?
Yeah.
That doesn't really rate a news story, but nevertheless is kind of interesting. And I honestly assume the audience would be like 400 or 500 Vatican Affairs junkies out there. I was astonished, you know, at how quickly that thing caught fire, and it really became my calling card, particularly in Rome, because of course in Rome people are not reading the print editions of American publications.
Right.
They are, however, assiduously reading everything written about them that is accessible online.
Mm-hmm.
So I became known there as the Word from Rome guy. The name of the print outlet I was working for, to be quite honest with you, very quickly became irrelevant.
That's true. And that's how I learned about you, and that's how I first started to see your coverage and started to follow you regularly. And you've got 10 books, and your new book is The Francis Miracle. And like we said, it's a biography in part. It has a sketch of him in one chapter, and then it moves on to his papacy and where it's at right now. But of course, he was the runner-up when Benedict became Pope, when Ratzinger was elevated to Pope, and he was the number two guy.
Yep.
He got the silver, I guess you would say. At that point, had you dealt with him? Had you interviewed him? Were you familiar with him, and did you change whatever that status was as soon as he became the runner-up guy?
Prior to 2005, I had met Jorge Mario Bergoglio exactly once. It was 2001. He was taking part in a synod of bishops in Rome, which is a kind of summit of bishops around the world to advise the Pope on some topic. This synod was taking place 4 days after 9/11. The guy who was supposed to be the kind of the chairman, what they call the relator of that synod,
couldn't get there.
Well, no, at the time it was Archbishop, then Archbishop, later Cardinal, Edward Egan of New York.
Mm-hmm.
Understandably, Egan felt like he had to go home because he couldn't like spend a month in Rome cooling his jets while this global tragedy is unfolding, you know, in his own backyard.
Mm-hmm.
I had set up an interview with him, which was in itself kind of unusual because if you know anything about Archbishop / Cardinal Egan, nice guy, not a big fan of the media in most respects. You know, nobody on earth would be happier if you told him you would never have to do another media interview, you know? And you notice in retirement, he's not doing a lot of it. Okay. Anyway, so he had kind of made a concession. He calls me up and says, "Hey, John, I know we have this appointment for an interview, but I've got to go home. I'm sure you understand." Now, the guy who's taken over for me is the Archbishop from Buenos Aires, and I told him we had this appointment, and he said he'd be willing to talk to you. Do you want to meet him? Now, you got to understand, sure. As an American reporter overseas, immediately post 9/11, mm-hmm. there's only one story we're doing, okay, right. Which is the global reaction to 9/11. All right, so part of me was inclined to say, thank you, Your Excellency, but it doesn't make sense for me right now. But then I'm thinking, maybe I can get this guy to say, even in Argentina, we're all Americans now, or something like that. So I said, sure. We set up this appointment for the Doma Santa Marta, which now, of course, is famous for being the place that Pope Francis is living.
Right.
At the time, it was just a hotel on Vatican grounds.
But a big one where a lot of people would stay.
Yeah. And when you go into the Doma Santa Marta, there are these smoked sliding glass windows that open when you walk in, and then there are these spiral staircases on either side that take you down to the reception desk. And normally, when you're meeting a kind of big fish, you go in, you go down, you go to the reception desk, you announce your presence, they call up to the room he's staying in, his flunky comes down, takes you to a waiting room. There's a whole protocol that has to be observed. All right, so this day, I walk in those sliding glass doors. There's a guy just sitting there in simple priestly blacks, okay, no insignia of office, okay? And I'm sitting in a folding chair, okay? And I'm kind of startled because I'm not expecting that. And he looks up at me and says, "Le'e Allen," which is, "Are you Allen?" Mm-hmm. I said, "Yeah, I'm looking for Archbishop Bergoglio." And he's like, "That's me." Okay. So, okay. And he says, "So where do you want to talk? We could probably get another chair." And I'm like, "Man, you really don't know how this works, do you?" Okay. Because all we got to do is walk down there, and there are this whole like retinue of guys in like white jackets that will escort you, mm-hmm. Into rooms if His Excellency wants one. So I got him into room, and then he turns on the lights and says, "Can I get you some coffee?" I'm like, "Again, you do not get how this works, To be honest with you, it was a fairly anodyne conversation, which was, by the way, Bergoglio's reputation in Argentina. I mean, this is actually why Miracle is in the title of the book, because there is something miraculous about the transformation of this man, because his reputation when he was in Argentina was, good pastor, good administrator, genuinely cared about the poor, but from a media and public, projecting a public face point of view, a total dud. Mm-hmm. He never gave interviews. He hated appearing in public. When he did, he came off as shy or dull. You will almost look in vain for a picture of Cardinal Bergoglio prior to his election as the Pope in which he's smiling. Okay, and that was the vibe I got from him that day. To be honest, I think I did a 400-word kind of quick turnaround piece on that interview, and that's all I ever did with it.
Should have saved the audio.
Yeah. So, when he was the run-up in 2005, I assumed at the time that what that was about, and I think it's true, having talked to cardinals who participated in that conclave, they weren't electing a rock star, okay? They were electing a guy who they felt could get the church's internal house in order, which they felt had kind of been on autopilot during the late John Paul years. Now, what overtook that logic in 2005 was the sense that a majority of those cardinals had that they had just witnessed the end of a historically successful papacy, and they wanted to keep the momentum going, and the best way to do that was to elect the guy who was John Paul's intellectual architect.
The vice president. Right?
Vice pope, so to speak. Okay. Now, that was different in 2013 because those management problems had gotten dramatically worse over the 8 years of the Benedict papacy. But that dynamic of momentum that you just don't want to squander wasn't there anymore. So that cleared the path, I think, for the election of a reformer. And so you ask me, did I change my impression of him after 2005? No, I had the same impression. I've changed my impression of him after 2013, but that's because the man has changed.
Mm-hmm. He's very popular in the media, and that has to be because he's good copy, in part. I mean, he is
scintillating copy.
I mean, he's disastrous sometimes, but in a positive way, he says things off the cuff.
Well, that's the thing. Even things that, like, other world leaders, if they said them, would get beaten up over. With this Pope, somehow it always seems charming or, so spontaneous as to be, beguiling.
Pope Francis, yeah.
Right? I mean, from a media point of view, this is my soundbite for it. The difference between Benedict and Francis is that in the Benedict years, the media assumed that everything they didn't like about the Catholic Church was because of the Pope. Now they assume that everything they don't like about the Catholic Church is in spite of mm-hmm. the Pope.
Well, and every pope gets a honeymoon. I mean, I remember when Benedict suddenly was like, oh, no, 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 he's adorable, he's charming, the crowds are bigger than ever, it's a miracle, we can't believe it, and the same thing has happened with Pope Francis. But
yeah, although I think Benedict's honeymoon was much more short-lived, and it was also much more of a mixed bag, because at the same time that some people were saying, oh, you know, he's not the guy you thought, there were also a lot of people running around recycling the kind of narrative about Ratzinger as kind of God's Rottweiler and the German Shepherd. I mean, in some quarters, as you know, he kind of profiled as the Darth Vader of the Catholic Church. I mean, honest to God, people could hear the Imperial Death March from Star Wars in their heads, you know, when he walked into a room. And I don't think he ever really shook that. I think it was inaccurate and unfair, but I think it stuck with him. And unfortunately, every time that Benedict seemed to be walking up to the brink of maybe changing the storyline, some new meltdown or some new crisis would erupt, some of it self-inflicted and some of it thrust on him from the outside. But in any event, there was always something fresh to feed the narrative. Now, the difference with Francis is that he had the historical good fortune of being elected without any narrative, really, and which gave him the opportunity to shape it for himself, and he did it brilliantly. I mean, I'm convinced years from now, the first 72 hours of this guy's papacy are going to be taught in graduate schools of PR as like the ideal way to introduce a new brand on the global stage.
Well, we've had good introductions before from popes. You know, go home and kiss your children and say it's from the Pope.
Yeah.
So what did he do that was different in it?
Well, I think it's a concatenation of things, but I think from the very beginning, you know, when he walked out of the Sistine Chapel after the conclave, for one thing, for the first time, we actually had video of that, which is a novelty. So you see the cardinals coming out of the Sistine Chapel, and you see the chauffeur-driven Mercedes papal limo waiting for the new Holy Father to pop in, and instead of doing that, he hangs out with the other cardinals and gets on the shuttle bus like one of the fellas, okay? And these images make the rounds of the world. The fact that a couple days after his election, he goes back to the Casa del Clero, which is the residence for clergy in Rome he was staying in before the conclave, to pack his own bag and pay his own bill, saying it's not a good example if the Pope doesn't pay his own bill.
Which Ratzinger did as well, right? Or other than
I'll come to that in a moment, okay? obviously, famously, when he steps out onto the balcony overlooking St. Peter's Square, and he says, I will give you my blessing, but before that, I want to ask for yours, and I'm going to kneel in silent prayer and ask you to pray for me. I mean, hell, the fact that the morning after his election, he calls his newspaper delivery guy in Buenos Aires to say, hey, I'm not coming back, can you please cancel my subscription? Now, you're absolutely right that Benedict did much of the same thing in the immediate wake of his election. I mean, the day after his election, he walked from the papal apartment over to his apartment in the Piazza Leonina in Rome, where he had lived for 20 years, to pack his own bag, okay, and carry it back himself. And before he did, he walked around and knocked on the four doors of the other cardinals who lived in that building. Not to say goodbye to the cardinals, because he knew he'd be seeing them again.
Yeah.
But to say goodbye to the nuns who did the cooking and cleaning, to thank them for being such good neighbors, because he'd actually gotten to know them over the years. He knew their names, he knew their families, he knew their stories, and he cared about them as people. Here, I think we run up against the power of narrative. I mean, why didn't that become part of the Benedict story? Well, because the narrative dictated that this was an aloof, autocratic arch-conservative, and therefore it just didn't compute. With Bergoglio, it became the narrative, right? All of those gestures of humility and simplicity, which are real, by the way. They weren't faux PR exercises. They're who he really is. But because there wasn't a competing narrative, that became the story about this man.
It was a little unusual that there was such a strong narrative for someone who became pope, though for most people who aren't Vatican watchers, Ratzinger had an especially high profile. Most popes are new to us, John Paul II.
Yeah, I mean, Karol Wojtyla, you know, the Archbishop of Krakow in 1978 was a total unknown. It's just that the difference between the media environment in 1978 and 2013 is that in 78 it took a while for a narrative to develop. You know, in 2013 it moves much, much, much more rapidly. I mean, really, I think the fundamental storyline about this pope was set 72 hours into the game.
So you wanted to look at his life and see, especially tell people his story and also see how it might influence his worldview and what kind of pope he might be.
Well, it's much more the latter, actually. I mean, the difference between this book and other Francis books that are out there on shelves right now, in English anyway, is that this is really the first Francis book that is not a biography, but it's about the papacy. I mean, as you say, it begins with a biographical sketch of Jorge Mario Bergoglio because you can't really understand him without appreciating something about his background in Argentina, his work in Latin America as a leading figure among the Latin American bishops and so forth. But very quickly, this turns into a kind of topical study of where this pope is going to go on all the kind of hot button issues that are facing the church. So finances, for example, he's launched an ambitious financial reform.
Well, that's the most positive thing we can talk about. So I was going to start with that, because if there's one story and one thing he can accomplish as Pope, if it's financial reform, that alone would be a massive success story.
Yeah, sometimes it's hard for people on the outside, particularly I think Americans, to understand how massive the earthquake in terms of money management in the Vatican and the Catholic Church generally, because this is intended, he wants to turn the Vatican from a case study in what not to do, which it has been historically when it comes to money, into a kind of an example of best practices that will have a leavening effect on the church everywhere. Because let's face it, it's not just in Rome that the Catholic Church sometimes has problems handling money responsibly, okay? But it's hard for Americans because, you know, what this is about accountability and transparency, which for us, this is like mom and apple pie, okay? I mean, it just sounds like boilerplate rhetoric, okay? We notice it when it breaks down, but we expect that people are at least notionally going to commit themselves to those qualities.
Well, much like democracy, it's a
this
new concept
is not,
for them.
This is not how it has worked in the Vatican. And to accomplish all of this, he has brought in a tough-as-nails Australian cardinal, a former Australian rules football superstar.
You make him sound like he's knocking people over while he walks.
Well, metaphorically, that's exactly what he's doing. I mean, listen, George Pell, this is the name of the guy, when he was a young man, was a bruiser in Aussie rules football. And if you know anything about Aussie rules football, it's basically the NFL without the pads. Okay, it's in a typical game, two or three guys get carted off on stretchers. Back in the day, George Pell was the guy putting them on stretchers. Okay, that's his personality type. I think Francis recognized you need somebody like that to bulldoze through kind of centuries of accumulated sloppiness and privilege and kind of attachment to old ways of doing business that might have made sense in the Renaissance but are simply totally dysfunctional today. Now, the jury is still out. I mean, you know, Pell, in the year he's been on the job, has moved the ball in ways that, if it were anyone other than him, are radically unlikely to have happened. That said, you know, Francis's new reform team has yet to deliver their first comprehensive financial statement in which they are allegedly, for the first time ever, going to come clean with an answer to that question that has historically been one of the mysteries of the faith, right? Which is how much money does the Vatican actually have?
And how do you define the Vatican if you're going to say how much money do they have? Because, of course, the Boston Archdiocese is separate. It's its own little world.
Well, I mean, this is one thing that a lot of people misunderstand about the Catholic Church, right? I mean, the mythology of the Catholic Church is that it is this rigidly centralized, ultra-hierarchical institution, which, when it comes to faith and morals, it is. But when it comes to things like money management, it is one of the most decentralized outfits on earth. I mean, there is no office in Rome, okay, that somebody is in front of a computer screen tracking how much St. Anne's Parish in the Bronx, you know, is going to spend on altar candles this month. It just does not work that way. And in fact, the truth is, the real money in the Catholic Church ain't in the Vatican. I mean, one term of comparison I like to give people is that what we know, now we have to get full disclosure from Pell, but what we know based upon past analyses of these things is that all in, okay, the total assets of the Vatican come to around $4 billion. Okay, now to give you a term of comparison, the University of Notre Dame in South Bend, Indiana, has assets worth about $10 billion, which means they could run the Vatican twice every year and have plenty of money left over for new football units. Mm-hmm. You know, or then you can get beyond the Vatican beyond universities into, say, Catholic healthcare systems, you know, which sometimes have assets valued in the tens, in some cases even hundreds of billions of dollars.
But when we're talking about Vatican finances and the Vatican Bank in particular, it's not just a question of, you know, old practices, laziness, messiness, it's not transparent. I mean, it's been a true moral blight on the church.
Oh, it's been a magnet for scandal, no doubt about it. But you're right, the first order of business for Francis's reform team is to make it impossible, or at least more difficult, for those kind of scandals to recur. And by the way, we're not just talking about scandals that are artifacts of the distant past. We don't even have to go back to the Vatican Bank scandals, the famous Vatican Bank scandals in the 70s and 80s, as grotesque as they were, and unresolved in some ways as they remain. Last year, okay, there was a guy, a Monsignor, who was a Vatican accountant, known around Rome as Monsignor 500 Euro, because he used to carry around these fat wad of Euro notes in his pocket that he would peel off to pay for dinners and cocktails and so on. who was allegedly making 30 grand, that was his official salary in the Vatican, yet he owns an extensive network of real estate in southern Italy. He has a private art collection that includes originals by Chagall and Van Gogh. He has the sumptuous luxury apartment. I mean, you didn't need an MBA to know that something didn't add up. This guy was arrested by Italian authorities for participation in a cash smuggling scheme that is worthy of a Jean Le Carré novel. Mm-hmm. Okay, later indicted for a separate check kiting scheme. And all of this is within the last 2 years. Okay, so the problem, the point is, and let me make this point. First of all, you've got to deal with the explicit corruption. Okay, but beneath that, you've got to rebuild a culture from the ground up, because one of the real problems with money management in the Vatican, there's a lot of behaviors that you and I would immediately recognize as corrupt that a lot of people inside that system don't see that way. For example, there's a cardinal who is still facing a criminal indictment for when he ran what's called Propaganda Fide, that's the Vatican's missionary department,
right,
that owns a lot of real estate in Rome.
Which is a really important charity for the Pope.
Yes, it's hugely important because it sustains the church and then what we used to call the missionary parts of the world. So, you know, Africa, Latin America, Asia, and so on. Which is now where the majority of Catholics in the world live, okay? So to call that mission is a bit of a distortion, but nevertheless, okay? And over the centuries, they accumulated an extensive set of real estate holdings, particularly apartments in Rome. This guy, what he was doing, he would make sweetheart deals on these on these apartments with Italian politicians. So he'd take an apartment that's market value was like 6,000 euro, give it to one of these politicians for two. And in exchange, when it came time to vote in parliament on allocating public money to rehab properties owned by Propaganda Fide, the understanding was they were supposed to vote yes. Mm-hmm. Now, I remember interviewing him when this whole thing broke. And he didn't deny it. You know, his response was, well, but that's just what you do.
It's Italy.
But it's Italy. This is how Italians of a certain level take care of one another. It's how business gets done. It's how it's always gotten done. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I'm 100% convinced that what he did, though it may be criminal, would not meet the traditional Catholic test for sin, which is conscious intent to do wrong, because I don't think he thought it was wrong. Mm-hmm. And the point is, that whole culture has to be torn down and rebuilt, you know, in accord with principles like transparency and accountability.
Do you think there's any serious consideration of just simply getting rid of the Vatican Bank?
I think there was. You know, Francis sort of floated that hypothesis when he was first elected. But I think what they've come to realize is that if they didn't have the Vatican Bank, they would have to invent it. Because there is a legitimate function that it performs. I mean, of the roughly $10 billion they have in management, the assets in management, the vast majority of that is not Vatican money. It belongs to religious orders and dioceses and Catholic movements around the world. And here's the kind of thing the Vatican Bank does. Let's say you've got an order of nuns, okay? Its headquarters is in Chicago, but they also have nuns in Cuba, okay? And you need to get money reliably to that community of nuns in Cuba. Well, the Vatican Bank can make that transfer for you, and they're not going to charge you an arm and a leg to do it. I mean, in other words, you'll get below market rates for doing that kind of thing.
PayPal works too.
I frankly think that if there were no, and of course it's not really the Vatican Bank, right? It's the Institute for the Works of Religion. If there were no such animal, then I think right now you would have study teams in Rome deciding how to build it up.
But it's only been around for 70 years, right?
Yeah, well, its predecessor has been around longer than that. Basically, it's been around since 1929. Which was the year of the so-called Lateran Pacts that settled. Basically, what happened is that in 1870, when Italy was unified, which meant the new unified government of Italy took control of the Papal States, these territories in middle Italy that used to be ruled over by the Pope, the Pope, from that point forward, claimed that those territories had been stolen, okay, and that he wanted them back. Okay. Roll the clock forward to 1929. It was clear, we're now in the Mussolini era, it was clear that nobody's returning that territory. But for political reasons, Mussolini felt like he needed to make compensation. So there was this lump sum cash payment made to the papacy. And to deal with that money, they created two things. They created a reformed Institute for the Works of Religion that would act as the bank for those assets. And they created something called the Extraordinary Section of the Administration of the Patrimony of the Apostolic See, APSA, to invest it. And this became the basis for the Vatican's investment portfolio and remains so today.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's really an area where he's still, the jury's out, but he's taking serious steps, and week to week...
Listen, the jury is out in the sense of whether this reform is going to work.
But he's really...
I don't think the jury is out in terms of whether he's committed to it. Mm-hmm. I mean, just in recent days, he said he issued a new set of legal statutes for Pell and the other two sort of financial oversight bodies he's created. And there was a lot of effort inside the system to try to convince the Pope to rein in these operations, to limit their powers, to slice off some of the big financial players from their jurisdiction, to give them greater autonomy. And basically, the Pope didn't blink, okay? Mm-hmm. I mean, he said, no, that's not what we're going to do. He made some changes around the edges. But, I mean, fundamentally, the decision here is I've created these bodies. I mean business. It is full steam ahead. So I don't think there's any doubt about his commitment. I think the only commitment is, over the long run, will it work? Because, you know, let's be honest, I'm old enough to have lived through previous cycles of alleged reform in the Vatican's financial systems before, which quite often have been kind of sound and fury signifying nothing.
Well, so that's an area where he gets a good grade as far as outside observers. One area where he doesn't have a good grade, perhaps, is women. And in your biographical sketch in this, you talk about him as the first pope who's ever worked for a woman. Which, you know, most popes, their context for women is their mother, their grandmother. Yeah. And this guy's worked with women as equals, as superiors, he has friendships, and that's unusual and kind of new for popes who are often raised and live their lives in cloistered, male-only environments.
Yeah, not only a woman, but a communist woman.
Right.
This was a chapter of the pope's early days, basically what we would call the period we would call grad school, basically. Mm. Where he was training to be a chemist at that stage of his life. So he was working in a chemical lab. Basically, it was an agricultural lab that ran chemical tests on food products. And his supervisor was a communist woman who he has repeatedly described as one of the major influences on his life. I mean, you know, remember when Rush Limbaugh beat up on him for being too critical of capitalism and called him a Marxist?
Right.
And he said, well, it's not true, but I'm not offended because I've known some good Marxists. Well, this is one of the people he was thinking of.
Right.
Okay. But what he always talks about is how what she really taught him was a work ethic. You know, he'll tell these stories about how he would perform a test that he was pretty sure, you know, it answered all the questions that anyone could possibly ask about a particular product. And, you know, and she would come back and say, well, did you run this test or did you run that test? And he said, well, I don't really think it's necessary. It's like, well, it doesn't matter whether it's necessary. And the question is, could we learn something from it? You know, and so his perspicacity in some ways dates from that experience. So yeah, this is a pope who is very comfortable in the company of forceful, educated, sophisticated, professional women, both in religious life, that is nuns, and also lay women. Now, you know, that said, I take on board that he gets a kind of mixed verdict on his record on women, because that comfort level to date has been matched by some very promising rhetoric. That is, he's talked about how he wants to see greater roles for women, including a greater presence at the levels at which decisions are made in the church. Mm-hmm. He's talked about a deeper theology of women. But when you get to the point of asking, what does that actually mean in practice, it gets a little fuzzy.
Right, and some other things he said, some of his famous off-the-cuff comments have gotten him in trouble, which raises the question of whether he's a liberal. And of course, when Americans think of liberals, they think of women priests and contraception in the context of marriage and priests being able to marry again like they did for most of the church history. And as you point out in your book, if you're talking about bishops and cardinals and the Pope, there are no liberals in the sense that Americans think it. There's nobody out there calling for women to be priests or priests to get married.
Among the bishops. Now, there certainly are people at the grassroots who would be making that argument.
Like me, of course. Yeah. But so, I mean, when you talk about is he liberal, is he conservative? Well, you know, every pope is liberal when it comes to social justice and the ills of capitalism. John Paul II, who's seen as very conservative, of course, decried the
I used to say about John Paul that on social justice issues, he was too liberal not only to get nominated by the Republicans in the States, he could not have gotten nominated by the Democrats
right.
because he would be seen as too liberal.
Maybe in Vermont he could have been a senator in Vermont.
Yeah.
So, I mean, when you talk about this Pope and his attitude towards women and what changes might come, you have to really be modest in your expectations.
Well, I mean, listen, let's be clear. You know, we've asked him, that is the press corps twice, has asked him the women priest question, and both times he's given us a flat no.
Right.
Okay, so that's not in the cards. We've asked him, what about women cardinals? Answer has been no. You know, what about appointing a woman to run a Vatican department? Answer, it depends on which one, but some of them have to be headed by cardinals. Listen, I think part of this is that Pope Francis, ironically enough, for being at a guy who is now at the absolute pinnacle of the clerical food chain, is in some ways remarkably anti-clerical. He doesn't like the whole clerical system. And therefore, he abhors the idea that the only way to be important or of value in the Catholic Church is to be a cleric. Okay, so he doesn't want to, what he always says is, I don't want to clericalize women. So he's looking for some non-clerical way to sort of boost their role. It's a fascinating project. It's just, I think this is one of those cases with Francis where there are times he will start a conversation because he knows absolutely and precisely where he wants it to end. And there are other times where he has a gut level instinct that something is important, but he's not really sure what the end game looks like. And I think the conversation about women in the church is an example of the latter.
Yeah, I mean, when you talk about people empowering the curia or in the bureaucracy, lay people in general, not just women, have trouble because if they sign off on a document, it may not even have any power or effect because they are not members of the clergy.
Well, now we're drilling down into inside baseball, but that's true of some departments and not others. But on the other hand, I mean, let me give you a couple of examples. I mean, Joaquin Navarro-Valls was John Paul, who's a Spanish layman, was John Paul's right-hand man for most of his papacy. He was his spokesperson, but he was much more than his spokesperson. I mean, he was his key advisor in Latin America. I mean, when John Paul was in negotiations to take a trip to Cuba, Navarro was the guy he dispatched. I mean, Navarro was part of John. There were two or three people who were John Paul's sort of core kitchen cabinet with whom he would not make an important decision without discussing it with them. Okay, and Navarro was in that circle. Okay, and that was not a priest, not a cleric, not a religious. I mean, that was a lay man who was, I think, by almost universal consensus, one of the two or three most powerful people in the Vatican. So it's not to say that this can't be done. It's just to say that if you want to see women playing roles like that, you have to be intentional about creating them. And so far, what we've seen is the rhetorical commitment. We have not seen the intentional follow-through.
But in general, if you want women to have a role in the church, to start off by saying, but you can't have any positions of power because power is ugly anyway. Who wants to be like us powerful men? It's a no-starter. I mean, if you cannot have an active and equal role in the church, you're never going to have an active and equal voice.
Well,
you're never going to be...
Listen, I mean, there are some people who are just never going to be able to get past the bar on women priests, who are just going to see that as a fundamental injustice, a matter of gender inequity that's a kind of anachronism.
Yeah.
And therefore, no solution short of breaking that barrier is ever going to satisfy them. And I understand the logic, and I understand the passion that surrounds that. That said, okay, I don't get paid to live at the level of ought. I get paid to live at the level of is. Okay, and at the level of is, the short-term political reality is women priests aren't happening. And so, therefore, I think what you're going to get, I think what you have, actually, is this kind of moderate clump in the church that whatever they privately think about the desirability of women priests realize it's not feasible in the short term. But at the same time, they realize the church looks like a boys' club a lot of the time. Okay, it's got a women's problem.
It is a boys' club.
Well, listen, I mean, I've covered papal liturgies, okay? And once you get past the rows of cardinals and archbishops and bishops and monsignori and so on, I mean, you're in the cheap seats before you even run into a woman. Okay, I get it, okay? But that said, I think that moderate sort of cohort is going to say, look, let's focus on what's achievable, okay? And what's achievable in the here and now is the Pope has said he wants to see greater meaningful leadership roles for women. Let's start talking about what they would look like and let's put them on the table. Concrete example is one of the most powerful women in the Catholic Church right now.
On the child, on the sex abuse scandal chair, the panel overlooking.
Oh, well, sure, that's actually not who I was going to mention, but sure. But no, I was going to mention Maria Emaus, who's a leader of a Catholic movement called the Focolare, which is the largest movement in the church, more than 1 million members worldwide. It's the only movement in Catholicism whose statutes actually require its president to be a woman. So it's very committed to the women's role in the church. She's proposed to the Pope, look, you've got this council of 9 cardinal advisors who kind of are your key advisors. Why don't you create a parallel council of lay advisors, both men and women, but at least 4 or 5 of those would be women, so that every time you have to make an important decision, you know, it's not just senior ecclesiastics you're talking it through with.
Since we're all supposed to be the church.
Since we're all supposed to be the people of God, you could have another body of people from all over the world, you know, who are providing you the lay perspective on these things. Now, to date, it's not happened. But that, to me, seems an imminently doable sort of solution that is in Francis's comfort zone. I mean, that is to say, it's the kind of thing he would do.
What's another area where you see him having a really positive effect so far, like he was with finances?
Well, I mean, if you mean the internal operations...
In your book, as far as the big topics that...
Well, listen, I think, you know, from an external point of view, I don't think there's any doubt that his most remarkable impact over the first 2 years of his papacy has been reshaping the public conversation about the Catholic Church. I mean, I remember, and I'm sure you do too, where we were on March 12th, 2013, the day before he was elected. Mm-hmm. Okay, if we're going to go on air or we're going to go in print to talk about Catholicism or the Vatican or the papacy, what are we going to be talking about? You know, we're going to be talking about child sexual abuse scandals. And we're going to be talking about Vatican crises, the Vatican leaks mess, and this, you know, horrible, you know, Renaissance-era Borgia-esque sort of, you know, panorama of guys trying to knife one another in the back. Or we'll be talking about bruising political controversies or whatever. And it's not the crackdowns on nuns. And it's not that those stories have gone away. They're still very much there. But that is not the lead item in public conversation about the Catholic Church or the Vatican or the papacy anymore. The, you know, the lead item is rock star Pope of the people takes the world by storm.
What sort of change has he had in the media operations of the church? I mean, because they are, I mean, the Pope doesn't give interviews.
Sowing panic.
He doesn't give one-on-one interviews. People would be surprised.
Well, actually, he does. I mean, he's done five or six of them since his election, which is already more than he did the 15 years that he was Archbishop of Buenos Aires.
And that's typically unusual for popes, though, isn't it?
Yes. I mean, John Paul II and Benedict XVI both sat down with particular journalists for book-length interviews.
Right.
In John Paul's case, it turned into Vittorio Missori's Crossing the Threshold of Hope. In Benedict's, it was Peter Zabel's book, The Light of the World.
But that's different from sitting down with
the That's
the
different
New York
with
Times.
Sitting down with a working journalist to talk about policy issues. Francis has done that five or six times, but his real innovation in terms of media accessibility, of course, are these airborne press conferences he does on all of his trips, which are just absolutely mind-bending. I mean, the first time this happened was when we were coming back from Brazil after World Youth Day in July 2013. Mm-hmm. And I gotta say, and this was a total surprise. I mean, nobody knew that this was gonna happen, okay? And you know, he comes back, you know, the panic Vatican spokesperson comes back 10 minutes before and says, the Pope has decided he wants to come back, he's gonna take questions, so organize yourselves.
Which is just like what the President does on Air Force One. He goes back and chats with the media.
Yeah, but the difference is Air Force One, as you know, there's only a pool of journalists, and most of the White House press corps is actually following on a chartered plane. I mean, pretty much the entire Vatican press corps flies in the plane. Mm-hmm. So instead of there being 10 of us, there are 70 of us.
Okay, oh, wow.
So it's a different dynamic. But in any event, you know, when you cover the Vatican, I mean, you lie awake at night, okay, in those dark hours, you know, dreaming of these moments when you will have no holds barred, no taboo, no script, you know, opportunities to ask the Pope anything you want. You never actually think they're going to come, but I mean, that's what Francis has done, and he's done it serially. Mm-hmm. You know, you ask, what's the impact of that been on his PR team? Drives him nuts. I mean, I will tell you, these guys wake up in the middle of the night in a cold sweat.
Trying to take away his cell phone.
Or, you know, trying to figure out what he's going to do or say next, because these impromptu phone calls he makes, you know, or these crowd plunges he does. Most of the interviews he's done, you know, have been with friends who have gotten backdoor access to him, you know, usually through some hookup in Argentina. So the Vatican's paid communication staff is learning about it when the news flash goes on their smartphone, you know?
But it's been positive, mostly.
Yes, overwhelmingly, I think from a PR and media relations point of view, the image of Francis around the world is positive. I mean, I think in some ways, from a media point of view, he is almost the new Nelson Mandela, okay? The new kind of like unquestioned source of moral authority, that if he's on the side of a particular issue, then that's where the angels stand, you know? Now, however, it needs to be said, that the internal Catholic reaction to him is not quite as uniform, and certainly in some sectors is not quite as euphoric.
But it's a little bizarre when they say, oh, he's too liberal, because they're not really reflecting his stance on social issues.
Listen, I mean, that's a reaction that you pick up largely in the West, okay, that is in Europe and the States. I think if you want a point of departure for thinking about Francis, let's remember he's not a Westerner, okay? And so the categories of left v. right don't occur naturally. You know, I think fundamentally what he is a Latin American pastor. And what that means is, on some issues, particularly the culture wars in the West, the what we call the life issues, he's going to profile as pretty conservative. And on other issues, you know, economics, war and peace, race relations, immigration, the environment, what Catholics often call social justice issues, he's going to profile as awfully conservative. But I guarantee you, he's not getting out of bed in the morning.
Awfully liberal for social justice issues.
Yeah, I mean, he would be, as many Latin American bishops are, okay, by North American standards, certainly, even the most conservative, theologically conservative Latin American bishops would typically have a much more critical take on free market global capitalism than even our progressive bishops do. You know, so geography, I think, matters tremendously in understanding where he comes from.
Which why it's going to be interesting to see what he does on the environment. He's preparing a statement. Is it an encyclical? Or I forget.
It is an encyclical letter, okay. Which is the most developed form of papal teaching, and this will be the first time any pope has devoted an entire encyclical letter. Although it's not about the environment, let's be clear. It's on creation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, he wants to begin from a Christian theology of creation. And then draw conclusions about the environment rather than beginning from whatever handbill the Sierra Club is putting out today and drawing conclusions about theology.
Mm-hmm. Nonetheless, it's going to be something that will touch on global warming and those issues.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, the whole reason that he wants to have it out over the summer, and it's the release date is sometime June, July, the whole reason he wants to have it out then, and he said this explicitly, is that he wants it to be out ahead of the UN Summit on Climate Change in Paris in December so it can to some extent shape the agenda for that meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And he's called for that meeting to engage in more courageous choices, which clearly indicates he believes that the choices previous climate change summits have made have not been particularly courageous.
So, and then when we look at another area where he's had less success so far, would be the child sex abuse and cover-up scandals, which he had a poor record, I would say, probably, you would argue, in Argentina. And as a pope, he's hopefully stepping forward and doing a better job, but we haven't quite seen that yet.
Well, the truth is, in Argentina, he had almost no record because there were relatively few cases that became public. I'm not saying the behavior wasn't going on, but in terms of cases that burst into full public view, there were relatively few. And
I guess his record would beg your pardon. His record was mostly just not wanting to,
he
wasn't meeting with people.
There are a couple of cases that came up in Argentina during the years he was there that people have tried to lay in his doorstep, but if you drill down, none of them are priests of Buenos Aires. I mean, none of them are guys over which he had direct responsibility, so it's a little unfair to expect him to have taken lead. But, I mean, that said, so he came in, I would say, with a lot of on-the-job training to do on this issue. Now, here again, we have a case in which certainly the rhetoric has all struck the right notes. I mean, he's pledged his support for zero tolerance. He said we must not take a step back from the commitment to zero tolerance of child sexual abuse in the church. He, of course, has met with victims, and I've spoken to a couple of victims who took part in that meeting, and they all say it was an enormously cathartic event, and he seemed genuinely moved. He, of course, has created a new commission in the Vatican, what they call the Pontifical Commission for the Protection of Minors, which is intended to be the tip of the spear for reform on this issue, led by Cardinal Sean O'Malley of Boston, who would sort of be the premier reform voice in the American hierarchy, which is another signal of his seriousness. He's brought in a couple of victims to be part of that group. So you now actually have victims of clerical sexual abuse who have the Pope's ear. Bear in mind, one of them, Marie Collins from Ireland, who is a woman who was raped at the age of 13 in a Catholic hospital in Ireland. In the 90s, she emerged as one of the early sort of courageous voices who was willing to step forward and take her story. She couldn't even get a meeting with her local bishop, okay? And now she's got the Pope's ear, which will tell you something about how the wheels have turned. So in that sense, I think many of the signals he sent have been encouraging. That said, if you talk to most survivors of clerical abuse, and certainly their advocacy groups who speak for
like SNAP,
the Survivors Network of Those Abused by Priests and others, you ask them to grade Francis, you know, at best they're going to give him an incomplete, because what they are going to say is that all this rhetoric about zero tolerance sounds great, but it's just words on paper if there aren't any consequences for making it stick. Particularly, so the question is, what do you do when a bishop drops the ball, when a bishop has a critical charge of child abuse against one of his priests and doesn't take the appropriate action? A lot of these critics would point, for example, to the case of Bishop Robert Finn in Kansas City in the States. This is a bishop who accepted a finding of guilt for a criminal misdemeanor charge of failure to report because he had a report against one of his priests and there was a several month gap between that report and passing it along to the police. And in the interim, we now know other children were abused. And yet that bishop is still sitting as the Bishop of Kansas City. The Pope did launch an investigation, but to date he hasn't taken any action on it. I think until people see credible accountability measures that aren't just on paper, but are actually being enforced, then I think at best people are going to say this is still a work in progress.
I think you can't compare it to covering the White House because you never did that. But if do you ever feel like you're sort of in a unique position because people can't speak to the Pope, they can't speak to cardinals, they can't, they're so far away. When they actually talk to you, they sort of want to hold you accountable for what the church is doing. They sort of want to...
Well, that is true. Now, it is difficult to get to the Pope, although much less difficult to get to this guy than the other two.
He hasn't called me yet, though.
I'm kind of mad because I'm one of the last people I know that he hasn't called. I'm kind of waiting for that phone call to come. You know, there's actually a comedy columnist in one of the Italian papers who does like a fake news thing at night, kind of our Jon Stewart, okay? Who actually recently did a column, okay, about 10 tips of etiquette, what to do when the Pope calls, okay, because this has become so common.
Yeah.
It's a bit mythic to think that you can't get to cardinals. I mean, most of the cardinals, there are
exceptions. I meant lay people, not a journalist. I meant lay people. They don't, those are people who...
Well, even there, I think these guys are a lot more accessible than they sometimes get credit for. But I take your point. I mean, the ordinary Catholic probably is not often going to be rubbing shoulders with a cardinal or a pope. So, yeah, because I kind of profile as like the Vatican expert or a Vatican expert. It does happen sometimes that when I blow into town, whatever people are mad at about the system, they want to take out on me. Fortunately, I think most people get that I'm trying to do information and analysis, and what conclusions you want to draw about it is up to you.
And this is a big year for you. I mean, you're turning 50, or you have turned 50.
I already have.
You already, well, congratulations. Yeah, very exciting. You've in a new position, as you have been for a little while, with the Boston Globe. You've launched this website, Crux, with the Boston Globe to cover Catholic news for your market. You see, is the world, I imagine, but really North American market.
In the first place, the market is the English-speaking Catholic world. Now, we hope within relatively short order to be available also in Spanish. But yeah, the market here is the world.
Spanish would be the second one you'd want to do, isn't it?
Yeah.
That would make sense.
Yeah.
And you, of course, have a new publisher. You have a new book. There's a lot of been changes in your life in the last few years.
Yes, everything you just said is true. Although I would say the fundamental change in my life for the last 2 years has been the redefinition of what counts as Pope news. Okay, for 8 years particularly, under Pope Benedict, who I cherish, by the way, but I got used from a media point of view, okay, I got used to the notion that the Pope is only going to be news once in a while, and it's usually on his worst days.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but there would be these long stretches of time, all right, in which the rest of the world really wasn't interested. I mean, I remember, for example, covering the Pope's trip to Benin, in Africa in 2009. That trip might as well have been in the dark side of the moon, okay, in terms of the American media's interest in.
Mm-hmm.
That is no longer the case, okay? We now live in a new world in which absolutely everything this Pope does has been redefined as newsworthy. I mean, honest to God, if I could get a CNN camera crew into the Doma Santa Marta tomorrow to watch him opening his mail, okay,
absolutely,
we'd do it.
Of course.
Okay, we'd carry it live.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know? And so it's just, we are now, in terms of the media environment, we are now all Pope all the time. That's the fundamental new dynamic in my life.
And that's exciting.
Yes, from a strictly mercenary point of view, it is phenomenal because it's great for business. Now, I have to admit, you know, there is that kind of old world Roman part of me that sort of missed those afternoons, particularly when I'm in the Eternal City, when there was nothing hot breaking, you know, and you could go to a trattoria, particularly when the sun is out and the sky is blue, and you could have one of these vintage 4-hour Roman lunches,
mm-hmm.
Where you're solving the problems of the world and there's no particular pressure to get back to your desk because, whatever, you can catch up on it tomorrow. We don't live in that world anymore.
Mm-hmm. The one quote's followed you around, which is very complimentary, but it says, you're the guy that the cardinals and the archbishops call when they want to know what's going on in the Vatican. It makes it sound like they're, hey, what time is that meeting tomorrow, John?
Yeah.
You know, where's everybody meeting for drinks after the conclave?
Yeah, not quite that order of stuff. And, you know, you have to understand, that's PR language, okay? Mm-hmm. And like a lot of other PR language, you have to take it with a grain of salt. However, this is another insight into the Catholic Church. So they think, from the outside, a lot of people assume that if you become a bishop, and certainly if you become a cardinal, then you've got to be incredibly wired. In terms of what's going on in the Vatican. I mean, you got to know all the players, you got to know what's moving through the pipeline, you got to know where all the bodies are buried, and, you know, all of that. Truth of it is, there is a small circle of, certainly the cardinals based in Rome, okay, would be insiders. Beyond that, there's a small circle of cardinals, either out of obligation or because they just like it, who make a point of spending a great deal of time in Rome, okay, to collect that kind of intelligence. But the vast majority of the cardinals of the world are far more focused on what's going on in their local diocese than they are on what's going on in Rome. Most of them don't even read the daily news bulletin from the Vatican.
So sort of like senators who are home in their home state more than D.C.?
Well, yeah, although we don't have many senators like that. I mean, I think this is much more like governors, okay, who would be attentive to what's going on in D.C. because in many ways it intersects with their lives. But on a day-to-day basis, you know, they're not reading the roll call, right? I mean, to figure out who got some new vice committee chairmanship or whatever. And that's where most cardinals are coming from. So it does happen quite often. I mean, just a couple days, my first day here in New York, yesterday afternoon, I did Cardinal Tim Dolan's radio show, the Cardinal here in New York. Mm-hmm. And, you know, off camera, we spent a little time, you know, chatting about what was going on with Cardinal Pell and the financial reform, and Dolan wanted my read on it because he's just getting it second or third hand, right? I think that's the sense in which it would be accurate to say that sometimes some of these guys do turn to me, not for any sort of deep, dark secret, and certainly not for the hookup for the best after-conclave party.
Oh. Okay. But as far as... what was I going to say? I lost my train of thought. It's completely gone. Oh, well. But when you're talking about your books and what you're doing now, you're in a great position. And your wife, you've described as the best-informed Jew about
on
what's
the face
going
of the
on,
planet.
On the face of the planet about what's going on inside the Vatican.
Does yeah, you know, I've spoken for the ADL a couple times, and I've tried to convince them to hire her as their in-house Vaticanista, because actually the ADL, like most major international Jewish organizations, is keenly interested in what's going on in the Vatican from the point of view of what it means for Catholic-Jewish relations and so on. But yeah, my poor Jewish wife, who quite honestly never started out with any particular interest in the inner machinations of the Catholic Church
or
Romanita or
anything. Yeah.
But, you know, by virtue of being married to me, she just kind of absorbed it by osmosis. And the comedy is when I can get her to come back with me to Rome now, and we go out to dinners, you know, if the conversation about what's going on at some dicastery, which is the Vatican word for a department, okay, what's going on in some office comes up, I can step away and, like, check my BlackBerry or whatever, because she's perfectly capable of just totally taking over the conversation, you know, and saying, no, that guy is a jerk. You know, here's the guy you need to talk to if you want to know what's actually happening. And, you know, I mean, you're talking about that motu proprio. Well, you know, this guy in this other dicastery wants to get his finger in that pie, so, you know, watch out, you know.
Well, which brings up, I mean, there are 2 billion Catholics around the world, but people who aren't Catholics should be interested in the Pope and what he does, because you can see with Cuba and in other international areas like global warming and Judaism, what an impact he has on the world and why they should pay attention to who he is and where he might be headed.
Sure. Number is 1.2 billion Catholics, 2.3 billion Christians.
Christians, I beg your pardon.
Yeah. But you're absolutely right. I mean, you know, that is a huge chunk of the human population, and so just by definition, it matters. But further, the Catholic Church, first of all, it's the only world religion that has its own diplomatic corps. It is engaged in global affairs in many ways in a much more direct fashion than any other religious body. And it matters. I mean, if you know, you don't have to be Catholic to draw the conclusion that Pope John Paul II was one of the key players in the collapse of European communism. I mean, you know, if you don't believe that, I can introduce you to some former Soviet apparatchiks I've met over the years who started crafting their exit strategies the night he was elected, okay, because they were smart enough to realize Polish Pope, aggressively anti-communist, this is not good,
yeah.
You know. You know, all the way up to, you know, the role that John Paul played as the leader of the moral opposition to the U.S.-led Gulf Wars. And as you mentioned, the role that Pope Francis played in the restoring diplomatic relations between Cuba and the United States. I mean, popes in the Vatican and the Catholic Church generally has an enormous reservoir of political and human capital. And whether they deploy that capital for good or ill is inevitably going to be one of the mega stories of our times.
And can you slip the Pope my cell phone number, just in case he wants to talk?
Yeah, write me a note, you know?
All right, well, thanks very much for your time.
You're very welcome.